Considering the penetration, what is the ballpark revenue percentage ratio from urban cities to tier regions like rural areas? What is the ballpark
So, as I said today, you know, almost about 65% of our business, and hence 65% of our revenue, is coming from the rural area, actually. Okay, and so just to give a split up, you know, 65% comes from rural area, 1% is coming from electric vehicles. Okay, rest is coming from say about 25% is coming from secondhand vehicles. And the balance small percentage, we do new vehicles in some cities, you know, maybe Hyderabad, Bangalore. We are not very fond of doing new vehicles in big cities, actually, because there are enough number of players doing it. The bike bazaar buying and selling part today constitutes about 4 to 5% of our revenues, but that's going to sharply go up in the next 4 5 years.
Considering the pandemic, there has been a boost of digital wave. How does Bike Bazaar execute its operation remotely without sacrificing customer satisfaction and quality?
Yeah, I mean, in the sense that, you know, there's a degree of limitation that what you can do digitally.
Remotely, yeah, of course, digital.
Yeah, and I think most of the people have started realizing it. Now, just to give you an example, see, we are expanding through this pandemic. We expanded in Bihar. Bihar was a new state. We went and we expanded. We today have almost we do almost about, you know, 2,000 vehicles a month in Bihar, which is pretty good. You know, we just started about 4 5 months back. But the problem is that, you know, we are not able to further expand it because, you know, unless we travel, unless we sit with the dealer, the sub dealer, unless you meet the customer, okay, you never get a feel about, you know, what that market is. Should we open it? What is the way we should do it? Okay, you have to have the tea and coffee with the dealer and the sub dealer. Okay, you have to do, you know, no amount of Zoom call is going to help you, because, you know, what he starts telling you is only after 1 hour, 1.5 hour of, you know, talking shop, actually. Okay, that's what we are missing. But now our people are fully vaccinated, most of our people, so they are traveling. Okay, they are traveling a lot. Okay, and for this festival, we need to, you know, really expand. We had a fantastic June. We had a fantastic July. Okay, because May went down because May was a real lockdown. So we are seeing that the numbers are going to really go up as far as the festival is concerned. So to answer your question, yes, we are managing digitally, we are managing things, but we still need to do a face-to-face kind of, you know, business.
That's the business. That is the business.
Yeah.
Tell us about the franchising model. What does it take to become a franchise?
See, unlike a lot of other people, we believe that a franchisee should know the two-wheeler business. If he doesn't know the two-wheeler business, then his expectations are very, very different. Okay, one of the reasons why we feel the second-hand vehicle market is broken is that there's too much of margin which the unorganized retail outlets are making, and we feel that this margin needs to be crushed. So, as a franchisee, if you come in expecting that you will make huge amount of money, tons of money, okay, by selling, you know, 15 vehicles, 20 vehicles, then you are not a franchisee for us. Okay, so we want a franchisee who's ambitious, who says that, you know, I will sell about 100, 150 vehicles. Okay, and my margins will be lower, but my overall profits will be high because I'll sell more number of vehicles and ensure that the customer gets a good deal. Second is that most of our franchises are dealers who already have a new two-wheeler business. Okay, and that becomes a very it becomes a seamless kind of integration. Because, you know, they already are into exchange of vehicles. There's already a set of customers who are coming in. They already have service centers, you know, which we can, you know, use, or, you know, at least they understand how to do the services if we have to, you know, make them a service franchisee also. So these are some of the things that we look at. Obviously, the franchisee should be able to own stock. Okay, so it is not as if, you know, we will own the stock, they will own the stock. So that is always there.
Considering how the pandemic struck us in 2020 and to now, could you talk us through the timeline of how the pandemic and the initial lockdown affected the business, and what were the value-added services, or you know, what were the improvisation that you had to do to the business to survive up until now?
Yeah, so I would talk about the phase one pandemic, and so I would say the wave one and the wave two. So wave one, of course, caught all of us by surprise. There was no doubt that nobody was prepared, and I think in the month of March, The first 2 weeks of March, I remember it so well. So the first 2 weeks of March, we were doing extremely well. And third week of March onwards, the pandemic hit and lockdown started in a lot of places. And the entire first quarter of the year, April, May, June of last year, were absolutely a disaster. Okay, where the entire businesses were shut. And if your shops are shut, and you don't know how this pandemic is going to affect you. And so the shops were shut. You didn't want to buy the product. So the entire business was shut. And we being a finance company, our biggest issue also was collection. Okay, and in our collection, almost 30 to 40% of our customers actually do not honor their NAC mandates or the checks which they give you. Okay, and that's normal in this industry because, you know, as I said, most of these customers, a lot of these customers don't have great banking habits, but they end up paying you. By the end of the month, you know, 95% of the customers have paid you. Okay, but now they are not able to pay you because, you know, our guys are not able to collect, they are not able to. So we had to improvise, we had to do a lot of digital payments. We already were signed up with all the digital, whether it's Paytm, whether it is Google Pay, everything we are signed up. Yeah. Exactly. Everything. So we had to hold their hands. We had to make them and understand how to pay that, how to do that. Okay. So we did all that. But our collection efficiency definitely fell. Okay. And the second quarter onwards, we saw a improvement happening. And as I said, the rural went up like this in the second quarter onwards, whereas urban took some more time, both in the sales as well as in collection. So we did a lot of things in the first pandemic, you know, I mean, since that customers wanted to pay, you know, we started accepting the payments in grocery shops, which are meant for, you know, some of the grocery shops were only opened, you know. So we tied up with a few companies, we made them, you know, start collecting at grocery shops, etc. and all that. By the time the pandemic 2 set in, you know, we were much more prepared, I think. I think everybody was much more prepared. Plus, even the government was much more prepared, and we didn't get into such a severe lockdown also. I mean, the lockdown was there for a year, month, but it was mainly in areas, you know, not all the areas were shut down, but May was bad again. Okay. And then June onwards, it improved. So today, I think we have learned to live with the pandemic. You know, there may be a wave 3, yeah, there may be a wave 4. One needs to know how to do business in spite of the pandemic now. Yeah.
Considering the scrappage policy, could you explain us how does it impact the two-wheeler second-hand market and the availability of components or spare parts? How does it impact the Bike Bazaar business model, scrappage policy?
Yeah, I don't think it impacts us at all because anyway, we were actually had a mental that 15 years, after 15 years, the vehicle is gone. Okay, though the vehicle doesn't go really. Right? I mean, today technology is pretty good actually. The vehicles last. But after 15 years, anyway, you have to do a passing again. Okay. Even today, even if there is no scrappage policy, you have to renew your RTO. So we would on average do not look at vehicles beyond 8-9 years actually. So to that extent, we are actually seeing now an opportunity in the scrappage policy rather than a problem. So because there would be a scrappage value which can be credited to the customer so that he can buy a newer vehicle. And especially when the customer wants to buy electric vehicles, etc., this scrappage policies can come very much in handy. You know? So I would say that, you know, one needs to watch how it's going to work because I don't think they are implementing this across India. They're implementing it only in a few pockets. And as I said, almost today, 60% of vehicles are sold in the rural areas. And in another 5 years' time, about 75% of the vehicles will be sold in rural areas. So we have to see how the scrappage policy will impact rural areas, whether they will be able to implement it, whether the government will be able to enforce it in the rural areas. It'll be great if they're able to do it, actually.
So my last question, considering how you already said that, you know, you would never probably venture into car bazaar or selling or leasing of cars, and considering that you are planning to finance rupees 250 crore through C-Series funding by the end of this year, an expansion to 125 cities. Apart from the aforementioned that I just said, what are the other future plans for Bike Bazaar?
Yeah, so I would say that, you know, see, we have raised almost 230 crores till now, and now we are going to Series C with a 250 crore raise. See, last year we did if you could talk about our total business, which is our disbursement plus the Bike Bazaar business, you know, we did about 325 crores. This year we are going to do 736 crores. And next year we are going to do 1,500 crores. And the year after that, we are going to do about 3,000 crores. So we are doubling. We are going to double every year. We should have doubled last year itself. But see, we did 326 crores in spite of doing zero in the quarter one. So in three quarters, we did this. We already started hitting, you know, 54, 55 crores per month kind of a run rate, which will, by the festival time, it will start hitting a 75 crore. So we are the fastest growing two-wheeler company in India today. As I said, the four verticals of financing second-hand vehicles, financing new vehicles in rural areas, building a strong EV business, both in leasing and financing, and building a strong services business, which is basically buying and selling of second-hand vehicles, both IC as well as EV, and getting big into service. Okay. So I think these are the things that we are looking at, especially talking about EV. We feel that, you know, that EV business will, electric vehicles will start really becoming big if there are companies which will start investing in the electric vehicles. So we are planning to, you know, do almost 1.5 lakh vehicles, you know, in the next 2 years in terms of leasing by owning the vehicles ourselves, actually. And that's I would say we will become the largest, hopefully, EV leasing company very soon, actually.
All right, sir. Thank you so much for your time. It was such a pleasant conversation with you.
Thanks a lot, Sumesh. And, you know, all the best. And I hope that we are able to do a face-to-face
meeting. Exactly, face-to-face meeting. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.